Good morning.
Welcome to River's Edge Community Church. Thanks so much for joining us for our worship service today. Today we want to continue in our summer series, which we are calling What's the Good Word? And today our good word is faith. Now, I would be willing to bet that as words go, faith has more acrostics than any other word. Now, in case you don't know, an acrostic is a 1950s mnemonic device where you define a word by using its initial letters. For example, the word fear can be defined as false evidence appearing real, or as forget everything and run, or as face everything and rise. Now, fear is very popular in acrostic land, but not as popular as faith. And what is faith? Faith is forsaking all, I trust him. Faith is forwarding all issues to heaven. Faith is full assurance in thanking him. Faith is forever, always, I trust him. Faith is feeling afraid, I trust him. Faith is forsaking appearances, I'll trust him. And I could go on and on, but that's plenty. Now, I'll admit that most of these are not that helpful. To be honest, many of those were pretty bad. But most definitions aren't helpful either. In fact, the most popular definition of faith is no help at all. And what is this most popular definition? Well, Mark Twain said it. He said, faith is believing what you know ain't so. As I said, not helpful. But if the acrostics or the dictionary definitions were helpful, then we wouldn't need to be here today talking about what faith truly is. But here we are, and I'm glad we are. Let us recite our faith together by reading three questions from the Westminster Confession of Faith dealing with the question of faith. I'll read the questions, and if you would, please respond with the answers. How does the Spirit apply the redemption purchased by Christ to us?
Spirit applies to us the redemption purchased by Christ by creating faith in us and thereby uniting us to Christ in our perpetual call.
What does God require of us that we may escape his wrath and curse due to us for sin? What is faith in Jesus Christ?
Faith in Jesus Christ is a saving grace by which we receive and rest on him alone for salvation, as he is offered to us in the gospel.
Amen and amen. Josh is going to come and pray for us now.
Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for another Sunday morning for us to be together. We are here as brothers and sisters in faith, hoping to worship you as individuals and as a community so that you are glorified in this place. Help us to set our sights on the risen Jesus. Let us remember the salvation he provides to us in the way of his death, paying the price for our guilt and shame. And then help us to become more like him so that the world may see our good deeds and glorify you in heaven. May your love be irresistible to all we encounter. I pray that the indwelling of the Holy Spirit be evident among us this morning. Help us to slow down, block out the intrusive thoughts that distract us, and set our eyes on you. For this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad. In Jesus' name, amen.
So when we think about faith, we have to think about our faith, but also God's faithfulness. Think about that as we stand and sing together, as you're able.
Sing praise.
may be seated.
Our prayer today is adapted from the Book of Common Prayer. It's a great prayer. After we have prayed it, I invite you to lift up the concerns of your own heart, either out loud or silently. The important part is that we use this time to pray to our God, knowing that He moves in response to our prayers. Let us pray together. Father God, we come to You knowing that You oversee all of life and that You have us in the palm of Your hand. We are not alone. You are here. You are walking with us. You lead the way, and You go behind us so that if we stumble, You will catch us. You are with us in the good times and in the hard times, for You are always faithful. We lift up our hearts to You now. Hear us as we pray together, saying, Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things in Your Son, the King of kings and Lord of lords, mercifully grant that people from all over the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under His most gracious rule. Increase in us the gifts of faith, hope, and love, and that we may obtain Your promise, empower us to worship You with all of our hearts, to serve You with all of our being, and delight in You all the days of our lives. May our lives be filled with loving those things that You love and walking only in Your paths. We pray this through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with You and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, Joe's going to come and read our text for this morning.
Our scripture reading today is brief, but it's very powerful, coming from Galatians 5, verse 6. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. This is God's word for us today. And now we can stand and sing together. Stand with us, please.
Deliver captives and to preach good news in every
Each Sunday as we begin, we have what we call This We Believe. It's a statement of our faith. But that's not the only time we make such a statement. We say This We Believe as we sing together. We believe these words. When we pray together, we believe that God hears our prayers and moves in response to them. And when we take an offering, we also are making a statement that we believe that God is good and faithful, that He has blessed us with all sorts of things, and that we want to respond to His gifts in thanksgiving. This we believe all throughout our worship service, and especially here, because it's not just our words that we are saying with what we believe, but in our actions. Let us demonstrate our faith by taking up an offering. At this time, let us dismiss the kids to go to their classes downstairs. Let us say the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face toward us and give us peace. Kids, you are dismissed. And half the church leaves. It's a good thing. There are brilliant sayings, and then there are brilliant sayings, which is to say that there are wise sayings that are absolutely brilliant, and next to them we have sayings from a pundit named Ashley Brilliant, whose sayings also happen to be brilliant. So here are seven brilliant, brilliant sayings. Number one, this one describes many of us right now. I try to take one day at a time, but sometimes several days attack me at once. How true that one is. Number two, here's some honesty. Not only don't I know what tomorrow will bring, I'm still not entirely certain what yesterday brought. Number three is a true confession. I can face anything except the future and certain parts of the past and present. Can I get an amen to that one? Yeah. Here's some optimism for you. I've learned so much from my failures that I'm thinking of having some more. That's me, perfectly. Number five is unfortunate, but true. Before I knew the best part of my life had come, it had gone. Number six, this one is so backwards, it has to be true. I wouldn't have seen it if I hadn't believed it. And last, a surprising admission. The only truly solid foundation there can be for anything in this world is faith. Here's the truth. Brilliant is not only brilliant, but he's right. The fact is, we all live by faith. Now, some of us choose to put our faith in karma. What goes around comes around. Others of us put our faith in science or in reason. I don't understand it, but some of us put our faith in government or in our educational system. And then there are those among us who have an amazing faith in luck. Everything turns on a simple twist of fate. And that brings us to the two most popular forms of faith today. Lots of people put their faith in themselves. And then there are those who put their faith in God. As I said, everyone has faith because everyone has questions that push them to believe in something that will silence the existential dread in their souls. There's a great story in Walter Isaacson's biography of Steve Jobs that makes this point profound. Isaacson writes, "One sunny afternoon, when he wasn't feeling well, Jobs sat at the garden behind his house and reflected on his death. He talked about his experiences in India almost four decades earlier, in his study of Buddhism and his views on reincarnation and spiritual transcendence. I'm about 50-50 on believing in God, he said. For most of my life, I felt that there must be more to our existence than meets the eyes. He admitted that as he faced death, that he might be overestimating the odds out of a desire to believe in an afterlife. I like to think that something survives after you die, he said. It's strange to think that you accumulate all this experience and maybe a little wisdom, and then it just goes away. So I really want to believe that something survives, that maybe your consciousness endures. He fell silent for a very long time. But on the other hand, he said, perhaps it's like an on-off switch. Click, and you're gone. Then he paused and smiled slightly. Maybe that's why I never like to put on-off switches on Apple devices. See, our deepest questions about life and death push us to have faith in something. But maybe we need to dig deeper here and ask what we mean when we say we have faith. See, lots of people contrast faith with reason and facts. Reason involves things that make good sense, and facts are things that we know are true because they can be verified. But faith, people say, is different. Faith involves things that we believe but cannot prove. For example, if I said I believe in Bigfoot, I'm kind of stuck. I may believe it, but I can't prove it. And some people say that's what faith is. And even if you said believing in the adorable Yeti was foolish, you probably could not dissuade me because I still believe it. Now, no one's going to get too upset debating the existence of the abominable snowman. But when we say we believe in Jesus, and someone says, that's ridiculous, then we have a problem. And we're back to Pascal, who said, in faith, there is enough light for those who want to believe and enough shadows to blind those who don't. Now, Pascal is absolutely right. But when the Bible uses the word faith, it rarely, if ever, is set in contrast to facts and reason. Not that there's anything wrong with facts and reasons. Not at all. God wants us to love him with all of our mind. And he wants us to know that our faith is based on solid truth. But when the Bible talks about faith, it has little to do with facts, but has everything to do with trust. See, facts and reason take place primarily in the head, but faith primarily takes place in the heart. Faith is a relational word. Let me explain some of that by telling you the story of Abraham. The first time we are introduced to Abraham, he was enjoying life in Ur of the Chaldeans. And why not? Life was good. He and his family had wealth, they had property, and they had status. And Ur was a happening place. It was one of the biggest port cities in all of Babylon. Ask Abraham, and he would tell you that the gods had been very good to him. That's right. Our Abraham worshipped the gods. But that should not be too surprising because everyone in the city of Ur worshipped the gods. And Babylon had many gods. And so Abraham worshipped all of them. But then one day, Abraham's father decided to go west and to seek his fortune. So he gathered up everyone in his family, loaded up the camels, and headed off to the hills of Canaan. And they walked and they walked and they walked and they walked. They followed the Tigris River north, past Babylon, past Nineveh, and just before they got to the Turkish border, they stopped and said, enough is enough. And so they settled in the city of Haran. Now let's talk some geography. From Ur on the Persian Gulf to the Turkish border is roughly 641 miles. If my father said, let's walk 641 miles just for the fun of it, I would get a new dad. In any case, they decided to stay in Haran and seek their fortune there. And life was good in Haran until Abraham's father dies. So when Abraham was 75 years old, he became the patriarch of the family. He was the head. He was the man. He was the boss. And part of his job was to protect the family, increase their well-being, and do right by them. So here is Abraham taking care of business in Haran when the strangest thing happens. God comes to him. God with a capital G. Now remember, Abraham worships many gods. He is a Babylonian at heart, and yet out of nowhere, a God he does not know comes to him and says, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. Now, put yourself in Abraham's sandals here. You don't know this God. You've never even heard anyone mention his name before. And you've never, no, not once, met one of his followers. And you know nothing about him other than what he said. And who knows? Maybe it was the goat cheese on your pizza talking. Maybe it was the mushrooms making you see things. You're 75 years old. You just walked 641 miles. Maybe the sun has baked your brains. And it is one thing to say that an unknown God spoke to you, but it is another thing entirely to say that this unknown God has called you to leave where you are living and to leave your relatives and to go to some unknown land way down south. And maybe it would be okay if it was just you, but you are the head of the family. Your job is to do what is best for everyone in your clan. Is leaving Haran and moving south in their best interests? I don't think so. And can you really believe this God? Maybe he's evil. How would you know? Plus, who would ask such a thing? No one. The very idea is crazy. You don't leave where you live and are safe and where life is good and move to some place you don't know, where you will not be safe and where life will be hard. It is an unreasonable request. And the number one rule of mental health is this: when the voices in your head tell you to do crazy things, you don't do them. Everyone knows that. And fine, if you want to move, if you've got money burning holes in your pockets, buy a vacation house in Carchemish and summer with the Syrians. That's a wonderful thing to do. But don't pack up everything and move 400 miles to a place you've never seen or even have heard of before, where the only security you will have is some unknown God telling you that he will go with you and he will lead you. Because that is crazy talk. Now, let's just take a quick survey. If we were Abraham, what would we do in that situation? All of us would agree, we would stay in Haran. And what did Abraham do? Look at Genesis 12, verse 4. Three simple words tell the whole story. So Abraham went. See, Abraham trusted God. He believed that this God who was speaking to him was good and that he would be faithful to his promises. And so Abraham stepped out in faith and went in obedience in response to God's invitation to bless him. Now that is some sort of faith. Abraham trusted God and followed him. I love how the author of the book of Hebrews tells this story. In chapter 11, we read, "By faith, Abraham, when called to go a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children, because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he, as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore." See, Abraham trusted God. He stepped out in faith because he believed that God was good, that God was trustworthy, that God would go with him, and that God would never leave or forsake him. According to Genesis, this wasn't a head decision. It was all heart. Abraham trusted God, and so he answered God's call. Now, this wasn't just a one-time decision. Abraham just didn't say yes, and that settled it for life. No, trusting God became a way of life. Everywhere Abraham went, he had to decide in that moment if he was going to trust God or if he was going to trust in his own wisdom and strength. And sometimes Abraham trusted God and great things happened. And sometimes he didn't and things fell apart. But here's the point. Trusting God is not a one and done decision. We have to continually show that we are trusting God through our actions. So we have to ask, well, what would that look like? And I would like to suggest it looks like four things. First, it looks like a relationship. Faith is trusting God because faith is a relationship. Now, this should not be too surprising because this is the way it has always been. In the Old Testament, God's people demonstrated their relationship with God by obeying the law. I wear a wedding ring to demonstrate that I am in a relationship. And we have been in this relationship for hundreds of years. In the Old Testament, God's people demonstrated their relationship with God by wearing and doing the law. But when Jesus came, how we demonstrated that we were in a relationship with God changed. We no longer have to keep the law of Moses. Instead, we live by faith in Jesus. We don't try to earn God's love through our good works, which would be a terrible misunderstanding of God's purpose for the law. But instead, we strive to live like Jesus. We follow the law of Christ, not out of ought and obligation, but out of deep gratitude and joy. You don't have to command me to love my wife. I am so thankful for her, I will gladly do whatever I can to show her that I love her. So it is with us. We follow Jesus because we love him. And as a result, you can't talk about faith today without talking about Jesus. Because Jesus is the faithfulness of God come to redeem us so that we can have a relationship with the triune God. We might say it this way. To live by faith is to live in Jesus, to live with Jesus, and to live as Jesus, because faith is all about Jesus. I mentioned earlier that every week we start our service here at River's Edge with a statement about what we believe. That's not unique to us. Lots and lots of churches do that. In fact, the great Swiss theologian Karl Barth wrote a statement of faith to encourage people in their walk with God. And if Barth was talking to Steve Jobs, I think this is what he would have wanted to say to that dying man about faith and about God. Barth wrote, "I believe that we are not alone. In our glory and in our misery, we are not alone. God comes to meet us, and as our Lord and Master, he comes to our aid. Of course, we cannot achieve and shall not achieve a togetherness with him. We do not deserve that he should be our God. But with undeserved kindness, in the freedom of his majesty, God resolved of his own self to be humanity's God, our God." I love that. Let me quote Nijay Gupta for some added perspective. Gupta writes, "Faith from this perspective is not a theology as a matter of first order. It is a relationship. God is with us and for us in the person of Jesus Christ through the Spirit. God comes to meet us, be with us, and help us. In that sense, faith is not something we do, and it's not something we think, but more properly, it is a togetherness we join by God's grace." And there it is. Trusting God looks like a relationship with Jesus. Second, trusting God also looks like holding on to him in the midst of terrible times. Think about Habakkuk. I know you're constantly thinking about Habakkuk, but think specifically about Habakkuk today. Habakkuk knows the people of Judah have forsaken God. He has complained to God many times about it and has asked God why God isn't doing anything to bring the people back to repentance. But then God responds, and it's not good news. God says he is going to bring the people back to him, but he is going to use the Babylonians to do it. He's going to decimate the land by the hands of the Babylonian army and drag all the survivors off into exile. But God adds, when they are in exile, they will turn back to him. Now, this is not good news. In fact, Habakkuk is horrified. So he starts to argue with God, saying, there has to be another way, a better way. You can't unleash Babylon on the nation. Yes, they will punish those who are violent and evil in the land, but they will also destroy those who are good and faithful. They'll also destroy your people, O God. And God says, I know this is a hard truth to grasp, but this is the only way. I will use Babylon to purge Israel. And when it is over, Israel will come back to me with all of their hearts and with all of their souls. In the meantime, Habakkuk, here's what I need you and the godly in the land to do. I need you to trust me. I need you to have faith that even in this I am good and that what I am doing is for the best. I need you to hold on to me even when your whole world turns upside down. Habakkuk 2:4 says it this way, the righteous will live by their faith. In the midst of trying and uncertain times, when nothing makes any sense and evil seems to be winning, God's people will hold on to God and trust in him and live by faith. They will walk by faith and not turn aside or lose hope. This is how C.S. Lewis defined faith in the Screwtape Letters. In the book, in case you're not familiar with it, Screwtape is a head demon, and he's writing to a lesser demon named Wormwood on how to tempt Christ followers and how Satan's horde will win or lose the war. Screwtape writes, do not be deceived, Wormwood. Our cause, Satan's cause, is never more in danger than when a human, no longer desiring, but still intending to do our enemy's will, God's will, looks around upon a universe from which every trace of him, of God, seems to have vanished, and asks why he has been forsaken. And still obeys. That's what it looks like to trust in God. It's not believing certain facts in your head. It's not being able to pass an exam in theology. It is trusting God in the midst of trying times. Third, trusting God looks like dying to self. Yes, trusting God brings life, but before it can bring life, it has to bring death, our death. Yes, faith is living in us. Yes, faith is Christ living in us. But faith begins with us dying in Christ. Paul writes in Galatians 2, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. This is from where Bonhoeffer gave us his famous quote. He made the same point saying, when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. Trusting God demonstrates itself in us willingly giving ourselves over to death so that Christ can live in us. See, who I am no longer drives me. What drives me is who I am in Christ. What I want no longer determines my actions. What determines my course is what Jesus wants. Never forget, faith is dying to self so that we may live in Christ. There's another great quote from the Screwtape letters. Screwtape, the demon, speaks some unbelievably great truth here. He says to Wormwood, when he talks of their losing themselves, he means only abandoning the clamor of self-will. Once they have done that, he really gives them back all their personality and boasts, I am afraid sincerely, that when they are wholly his, they will be more themselves than ever. Don't miss that last line. When we are wholly his, we will be more ourselves than ever. We give ourselves to God, trusting that in our death, he will give us life. And not just a life, but a life beyond our wildest dreams. Last, trusting God looks like loving God and loving others. In our text this morning, we read, "For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love." The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. Now think about that. In Paul's day, the question, the one that was causing all the problems, was how should Christ followers live out the Old Testament? Should we keep the law? Should we eat kosher? Should we be circumcised? These were huge questions, and they were splitting the church. And Paul is running around telling everyone, no, we don't have to become Jewish in order to become Christ followers. But that wasn't helping. In fact, it created other problems. See, obeying the law was the way God's Old Testament people showed their loyalty to God. And if we threw the law out the window, what would we do to demonstrate our loyalty to God? What would we do to demonstrate our faith? If you took away the law, how could we show that we are now God's people? What do we do? And Paul says, listen, circumcision and the food laws and the rest of the law are no longer the way we express our faith. They were good back in the day in that they pointed to Jesus as the incarnation of God's will, but now they are obsolete. They no longer define what it means to trust God. They no longer define God's will for us. Something else does. Something that all the laws pointed to but could never achieve. Here is the law of Christ. This is how we demonstrate our trust in God. We are to love God and love others. And that is brilliant. To have faith is to love. To step out in faith is to step out in love. To live by faith is to live in love. To trust God is to love in every direction. We said earlier that faith is forsaking all, I trust him. But the truth is that faith is, first of all, I live by love. Now, I know that spells fail with two L's at the end. But if we fail to love, we have no faith. Love is the very essence of faith. We demonstrate our trust in God by loving the people he puts in our path. The story is told, true story, of a famous tightrope walker who decided to demonstrate his skill in the scariest of places. This was in the early 1900s. And he put a tightrope across the Niagara River close to the falls. He knew, and everyone else knew, that if he fell into the river, the current would carry him downstream and over the falls to his death. So this was a dramatic demonstration of his skill at tightrope. The day came, and our tightrope walker came out and addressed the crowd, and he asked them if they believed he could walk across the river on that tightrope, and the crowd went wild with approval, and so he mounted the tightrope and cross the river. When he had accomplished that, he asked the audience again if they believed that he could make it across a second time, but this time pushing a wheelbarrow. And again, the crowd roared with enthusiasm. They believed he could do it, and everyone was shouting and clapping and yelling. And so off he went, this time pushing a wheelbarrow to the other side and back. Upon his return, he addressed the audience a third time. He asked, "Do you believe I could walk across the tightrope pushing a wheelbarrow with a person in it?" And the audience went absolutely berserk. "You're the greatest, we believe," they shouted. Then he turned to the audience and said, "Okay, who will volunteer to get in the wheelbarrow and let me push them across the river?" And the audience fell silent. Nobody moved. Nobody volunteered. They believed, but they didn't trust. And so it is with us. We believe many things about God, but that's not the real question. The real question is, do we trust God with all of our being? Because that's what it means to have faith. Let's pray. Father, many of us look out into the future, and it's very uncertain. It's scary. It's difficult. We have people that we love enduring such hard times. It's hard to trust you in the good times. And it's so hard to trust you in the bad and the terrible and the scary. And yet you are faithful. Our songs today reflect that you are faithful. You are good. Our faith, our trust goes back and forth, but you are always faithful. Help us to cling on to your faithfulness. Help us to learn to trust you with our whole being each and every day. Help us to give our lives to you so that we may die, so that we may be resurrected. Help us to have faith in you. Help us to trust. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with us and we'll sing to try and affirm that faith together.
Don't forget, August 11th is our outdoor service with Howl afterwards and ice cream after that. It will be a great day. The blessing of God. The grass withers and the flowers fall because the breath of the Lord blows on them. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God endures forever.
For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is his faith expressing itself through love.
Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. God bless you all. Have a great, great week.